Today we are going to have a lesson on the Unit 3 of your HU401 syllabus, which is again a part of an extended part of managerial skills and professional skills. Now we have already done managerial skills, time management, conflict management, anger management, and we have also done professional skills. So, but we must remember that time, the managerial skills or the professional skills that we have done is in no circumstance a bounded entity. By bounded entity, I mean there is no definite fact that only this is included within managerial skills or that is included within professional skills. The birth is pretty wide, and a lot of essential qualities and abstract features are taken into account under these platforms. So today we are going to do something which is an extension of managerial skills, which is we need to do two more managerial skills. One is teamwork and the other is leadership qualities. So we are going to approach teamwork today. So again, this is not something which is directly related to English language. As I told you, the name of your subject is business communication. And so a lot of management related topics have been included because these are essential skills that you need to know to first get a job and then survive at the job. So today we are going to do with teamwork. So what is teamwork? We all know that when a group of people come together, share their ideas, divide a work amongst themselves and work together, it is called teamwork. But we need to know this a bit more technically. The concepts of teamwork, the features of teamwork, all these for your exams. So what is a team? A team is a set of people with a range of different skills brought together to contribute to and achieve a mutual organizational goal. Completion of the given task most efficiently within the allotted time should be in its chief objective. So this is a team. There may be a question in your exam defining team for, let's say, 3 or 4 marks. So what is a team? A team is a set of people in which is a group in which different sets of people with different skills, with different temperaments, with different knowledge bases, different skill sets are brought together and combined in a mutual organizational goal. So irrespective of the fact that your skill is A and someone else's skill is B, someone else's knowledge set is C, you will all combine together, teach each other your skills, learn from them, their skills, their knowledges, and discuss and try to find a common way by which the organizational goal can be fulfilled. So the organizational goal is the thread that binds every member of the team together. Whatever you do within that team, the objective is to meet the organizational goal. For example, let us consider any sports team, a cricket team or a football team. There are 11 members who have different skill sets. Someone is very good at, someone is very good at hitting fours and sixes. Someone is very good at bowling fireball Yorkers. Someone can score very good goals. Someone is very good in stopping other people score the goals. So they have different skill sets, and their skill sets and knowledge bases are very different from each other. But they work together. They combine their skill sets together. They share their knowledge bases together so that the common unified goal can be reached, which is to win. Which is to win. The common unified goal of any sports team is to win. And so this is a team where different people of different skills, different knowledges come together, share with each other their skills and knowledges, learn from each other the skills and knowledges, and contribute to the completion of the organizational goal within the allotted time limit. Again, time becomes very important. We had done time management, and I had told you how time is money in the modern 21st century industry. And so anything that you cannot do within a time is considered as a loss. Even if you do it properly without any faults, it is still considered not as a success, it is considered as a failure. So completing the organizational goal within the allotted time limit is the chief idea or the chief objective of a team. So again, so we discussed what a team is. So now let's discuss what a team, what teamwork is. So it is a collaborative group effort, a part of high performance organizational model today. The context includes an industrial organization, athletics, schools, anything. Assessed on the basis of the quality of output, the process and the members' experience. So what is teamwork? It is a collaborative group effort. As I told you, different people with different knowledges and skills are brought together and they collaborate with each other. They share this with each other and learn this from each other. So if you get a set of people and someone in that set does not want to collaborate, does not want to learn from the others, or does not want to teach the others his or her own skill, then that person is not congenial for teamwork or building a team. That person should be eliminated from the process of team building because that person does not contribute to teamwork. It is a part of high performance organizational model today. Now, this is a very technical management aspect, high performance organizational model. The high performance organizational model says that to perform at the optimum level, to perform at the greatest possible level, an organization needs diverse people, people who are different in their approaches, different in their thought capacities, different in their abilities, different in their knowledges. If an organization consists of only unidimensional one type of person, then their performance chart is going to come down. The objective of any organization is to see that the performance chart is shooting up. It is going towards the sky and not coming down towards the ground. So if it is coming down towards the ground, it means that the performance has been not very good. And if a performance is not very good, then the company is incurring a loss. If a company is incurring a loss, then it has no reason to keep you as an employee in the work. So the high performance organizational model says that that the tasks which have to be done in the 21st century industries are so diverse that it is impossible for a single person or a single type of people to complete it. They need a collective effort of multiple peoples who specialize in multiple things. Only then can the performance model, the graph rise. Graph of the organizational model go towards the x axis and not towards the y axis. The context includes, well, where do we need teamwork? Industrial organizations, sports teams, schools, everything, everywhere. Even see, when you do assignments or group projects, you need teamwork there. You are given a project, you will see that if there are four people in your group, you will see that each of them specialize in something. If you see that all the five people in the team can do only one work, and nothing apart from that work, you will see that you're not able to do the project yourself. And what you do when you get a project is something that you, something which is called, something that you, that by which you distribute the work amongst yourself. Delegation, what we call delegation. How do you distribute the work amongst yourself? You distribute the work amongst yourself by virtue of your skills and your strengths. Each person has an individual strength and they take in that. And how is teamwork assessed? It is assessed on the quality of the output, the process and the members' experience. So it does not matter how much you know. It does not matter how much you know. It does not matter how much you know. It does not matter, well, how much knowledge you have, but if you fail to deliver in meeting the common organizational goal, then the entire process becomes counterproductive and you become a liability. So, yes, it is true that teamwork is when different types of people of different skills and knowledges are brought together, but those skills and knowledges only have any value if you can complete the work in the corrected time period and help the organization meet its collective goal. And how is a team created? Well, the team is created on the basis of quality, experience of the members, if they can do the work, assessment of the output that these members have given in their previous works. You know, process, we see the process and we see who is best placed to work in that process. A team characteristic. So as you can see, the team, the word team is an acronym. It means together everyone achieves more, which is again the motto of 21st century industry, that you cannot work alone. Any person who wants to work alone is a liability to the organization, no matter how skillful or knowledgeable that person is. To achieve, the organization needs people who will work together and help the team to achieve more. So what are the characteristics of a team? Each team member should be highly motivated to complete their well-defined work and remain satisfied performing them. This is perhaps one of the most important, that each team member should be highly motivated to complete their work. They are given the work according to their skill sets. If they are not given the work according to their skill sets, then they must learn the work from those who know the work. And they should be highly motivated in completing their work and be satisfied while performing them. No one wants a team member who is not satisfied or does not want to do a work. Even if you are given a work which you do not know how to do, you need to learn it and complete it. And if you do it in a very half-hearted, lethargic fashion because it is a work that you do not like to do, you will see that you are, first of all, you will not be satisfied with the performance. Your team members will not be satisfied with the outcomes that you give. The organization will not be satisfied with the outcomes that you give. And this makes a liability this makes you a liability to everyone, your team members and even the organization. So attitude is very important and it should be highly motivated and enthusiastic. No one wants a lethargic member. High levels of interdependence to maintain high trust, high levels of trust, risk taking and performance. Interdependence means when people depend on each other, when people are not saying that, well, I am the king and I can do everything myself, but they depend on each other. As I told you, they learn things from each other. They teach things to each other. They help each other out. This is called interdependence, and interdependence is highly important in teamwork, in creating a team while working as a team, because it is the only way by which you are going to get the job completed in the proper fashion. Because as I told you, there may be a work which you do not know and you need to learn it from someone, and hence the interdependence. Or you are coordinating with someone, both of you or the team is coordinating with each other to complete the work properly. So you need to coordinate with the other person and do the work accordingly. You cannot work just according to your wish or as you like. And interdependence needs trust, risk-taking ability and performance. So you need to trust the fact that the other team members are doing the work in the best possible way. You need to have a risk-taking attitude because you are trusting a complete stranger. And performance. You need to trust each other's performance. You have to have faith on each other's performance and believe that at the end of the entire process, your collective performance will meet the organizational goal. Efficient cooperation shown through workload sharing. Well, this is again very important, workload sharing. Workload sharing has become a very important organizational statistics in the 21st century. The fact that everyone needs to work equally, no matter if you are a senior or a junior, no matter if you are a senior or a junior, the ethics of management states that everyone needs to work in a very equal manner. And teamwork can only thrive properly when everyone distributes the work within themselves in proper equal manner. So someone might have a little bit more work than the others, but it is not that someone is doing all the work and the others are doing no work at all. Its size can vary from 2 to 100 depending on the nature of the work. Anything, it can be anything. A cricket team, a football team has 11 people, but consider the parliament. Consider our government. So many hundreds and hundreds of people are working together to meet a common goal. They are coordinating with each other to meet a common goal, which is the welfare of the citizens of this country. There must be high level of interdependence among team members. This I already explained. And healthy team dynamics include open communication to avoid conflicts. Now, this is again very important in 21st century managerial aspects. Open communication means everyone can communicate with each other and directly communicate with each other. There is no chain of command. Chain of command means that you communicate with only your superior and your superior communicates with only his or her superior. But in 21st century managerial norms, there is no chain of command. So anyone can approach anyone and speak to anyone. So this results in not only allowing them to express their views or their concerns to the others in the team, to the superiors, but also helps avoiding conflict. Because as we know, communication can become very problematic when it is passed down from one level to the other. On the first level, the communication is A. On the second level, the communication becomes A dash. Then the third level, the communication becomes A dash dash, and so on and so forth. So you see, there is a difference between A and A dash dash. So this, to avoid this, modern 21st century organizations are doing away with chain of command. There is no chain of command, and everyone can openly communicate with anyone, ask questions, deliberate, clear their doubts, anything. Why teams are good for organizations? Well, they prompt in decision making and problem solving because there are a lot of people involved. Many of them, they can reach a consensus together, work together to solve a problem or do something in a new proper fashion. High coordination and control, better discipline, collaborative climate. High coordination and control, people are coordinating with each other. They're learning things from each other. And teamwork is also enhancing their interpersonal communication skills, their interpersonal skills of their personality, where they are starting to trust people. It affects their attitudes. It gives them a positive attitude. It teaches them more skills and knowledges. It allows people to learn more and more things. Principled leadership. Now, principled leadership is the person who is the best in a job attains leadership in that work. So there is a hard and fast ruler by name, but he does not kind of rule everyone around just like that. So how it works is that, consider we are in a team and I am a very good defender. I can stop people scoring goals very much. You are a very good striker. You can score goals very well. Someone is a very good winger. He can supply balls to the people, to the strikers to score goals. So the point is, see, we are going to learn and have faith on the individual leaders in these skills. So when the team is defending and everyone in the team is defending, then I will act as a leader and kind of try to direct all of you on how to defend better, because I know defending best, and you are all going to listen to me because you acknowledge the fact that I defend the best. Similarly, when we are attacking, I will listen to you, what you have to say, because I know that you know attacking better than me. So this is called principle leadership. Leadership according to the qualities. High result driven and goal oriented. This is something that I've already explained that then the purpose and the main objective of teamwork is to find results. The bottom line is to come up with results. Highly skillful and competent team players with greater task greater task commitments. This is also what we have expressed, that in working together, the team members become competent. The team members start to learn new skills and they become competent, and they start to take greater commitments for the completion of a task. Improves creativity and innovation, brings change. This is again very important. Creativity and innovation is something which is very important in 21st century industries. To do a work in an innovative fashion, which is different from the competitors, has become almost like a norm in 21st century industry. Almost like the primary feature. And so when a group of people come together and they are doing the work in a collaborative fashion, I mean, people give the ideas, and the ideas are not fixed. People come up with different ideas, and we can choose the best idea. The best idea may not be the idea which has been historically followed till that time limit. It may be something new. And so we, in bringing up something new, we are bringing in innovation. Stages of team building. This is again a absolutely management topic. Bruce Tuckman's team development model. You need to remember the name Bruce Tuckman. So the first stage is forming, where different people of different backgrounds and different skills and different knowledges are brought together, and the ambiguities are dealt with. Ambiguities are dealt with means the fact that who knows what and who does not know what, we get a clear idea of that, so that we know whom to assign what work and who does what work. Second is storming, deals with the conflicts and competitions of power and authority. Now, conflict is again coming to a common goal and trying to find one leader, or trying to establish the area or the pattern of principled leadership. So we discuss amongst each other, introduce each other, and speak about each other, what our skills are, how, show them how our personalities are. And we try to find out a common leader first, and then principled leaders, who is best is in his or her fields, who can help the others learn from them. Then comes norming. Cohesion occurs through increasing levels of solidarity and interdependence. Norming is a process when, after all these, when people are now aware of their skills and their lacks, how they are different from each other, they come together, and knowing how they are different from each other, even knowing how they are different from each other, they try to gel into one cohesive team unit, which depends on each other for improvement. And the last is performing. This requires high cooperation, a comfortable environment to begin the teamwork. So performing can only begin when everyone is satisfied with each other, is happy with each other, there is no discontent in the team, no one is angry with each other. And so performing only happens when the interdependency reaches the absolute core limit. Everyone trusts each other, has faith in each other, there is equality in the team, and only then can a comfortable working environment be created. And that with teamwork, the organizational goal can be looked to be met with. This is something important. Stages of team building, Bruce Tuckman's team development model is important. Okay, now what are the processes? Processes of teamwork, there are three processes: transition process, action process, and interpersonal process. Like, process of teamwork is how does teamwork happen? Transition process is task analysis, goal specification, and strategy formulation. So the first process of teamwork is that we analyze what the task is and come to a consensus about the goal. So if we are a cricket or a football team, then the task analysis is the fact that we have to first bat and then we have to then bowl or vice versa. And the goal specification is that we need to score more runs than the opponent. In case of football, the task analysis is that we play on a field 22 people with one ball, with one football for 90 minutes. And the goal specification is that we need to score one more goal than the opponent or stop the opponent from scoring one more goal than us. Strategy formulation, how are we going to get to this task? This task of scoring one run more than the opponent or the task of scoring one goal more than the opponent, we need to create a strategy how we are going to accomplish this. This is called a transition process. Action process is monitoring progress towards the goals, system monitoring, team monitoring and backup behavior and coordination. Action process is now when we, after making the strategy, we are putting the strategy to physical use. So we have made a strategy that we are going to attack during the power plays and then we are going to defend in the middle overs and then again we are going to attack in the death overs. Now we put this into action. And while the work is going on, we analyze if our action is going properly. So just consider the fact that consider we start a football game with the mentality that we are going to attack in the first 10 minutes and score. We are going to attack in the first 10 minutes. And then we start playing according to that strategy. But we see that because of us overly attacking in the first 10 minutes and not emphasizing more on defense, we are now losing by 3 goals in the first 10 minutes. So are we going to play the rest of the 80 minutes in that same strategy of all-out attack? No, we are going to reassess our performance. And now we are going to start to think of something, some else strategy, which is going to help us come out of this problematic situation. And so systems monitoring means seeing how well our strategy is yielding results, Team monitoring and backup behavior, how the individual team members are performing. Backup behavior, if someone is not performing to the best of the ability, we replace it. If our strategy is not getting performed to the best of the abilities, we replace the strategy altogether. And coordination, as I told you, interdependency. And this last is interpersonal processes, conflict management and motivation and confidence building. Well, when we work in a team, it is imperative that sometime or the other we are going to quarrel. But when we quarrel, we need to manage the conflict. The team needs to manage the conflict. The team cannot just let us quarrel and break everything, because it is only going to harm the team and the final result. Motivation and confidence building. Now, this is again a very, this is a process which is again, is considered very highly in 21st century industries, that the team, there should be an attitude of confidence and each member of the team should be motivational towards each other. So even if they see a person who is doubting themselves or is unable to do the work, they are not going to castigate the person. They are not going to point their fingers at the person and say, hey, you cannot do the work, you're so bad, get lost. No, they are going to motivate the person into becoming better employees or doing the work in a better, proper fashion. So these are the processes of teamwork. Why do teams fail? Again, we need to do the barriers. The barriers of teamwork. The barriers of teamwork are conflicts, internal, external, both can be disastrous. Now, this is something that we see that there are conflicts. There are conflicts between team members and this conflict can have disastrous results. Lack of motivation for individuals, both personal and professional. Lack of motivation, you're not willing to do the work. You don't know the work and so you're not willing to do the work. Or the fact that you had some personal problems and so you cannot concentrate on your professional work. Poor leadership leading to poor planning, poor workload or job distribution, no clarity, etc. If the person who you choose as the leader is not a very good leader in reality, the distribute, the delegation of the workload has been improper. People have not got jobs according to their strengths. There is no clarity about who should do what work. There is no proper planning as to what strategy should be followed. And poor communication, which is misunderstandings, ego clash, poor coordination, and etc. So again, this is again something that we see in everyday life. There are misunderstandings, and misunderstandings tend to hamper the team spirit. There are ego clashes. If he tells me I am wrong, what makes him think that he knows better? We are proud. We are human beings are proud people, and we have an ego. And if anyone tells us that we are wrong, we kind of get offended. Poor coordination is again something that I've already discussed. So these are the barriers of team management. Teamwork. Well, you can call it team management, but as it is popularly known, teamwork. Now, I will upload notes onto the forum. So, and of course, we will do this in a live class. But I hope that this class gives you an idea about this entire thing. Some team members' qualities, now again, this is not very important as the others. Disciplined and timely, attentive and listening, participates wholly, keeps to commitments, open to ideas of others, sharing information, ideas with others, and collaborative. These are all the points that we have discussed in details in the course of this lecture. So a team member should be disciplined, should be attentive, not egotistic, should keep to commitments, be open to other ideas, not believe that he knows or she knows everything. And so he or she should be adjustable, not very rigid. And he or she should share information with each other and learn more things from each other. The best teamwork guideline. Now, this is again a little important. Question on this is again important. Best guideline for the guideline for a teamwork means how do we get the best possible teamwork? Effective communication, creating the best working environment, best teamwork agreement. Effective meetings help to make the goals and guidances clear. Immediate conflict management, proper time management. Now, we have discussed all these in details in the course of this lecture. So just I'm going to explain each of these points in one line. These points in one line. So effective communication, there is effective communication, no misunderstanding between each other. Creation of the best work environment, people trust each other. There is a calm, faithful nature in the workplace. Effective meetings help to make goals and guidelines clear. Not having meetings just for the sake of having meetings, but having meetings so that the strategies can be fine-tuned and the goals can be visited and revisited. Immediate conflict management. If there is a conflict, immediately the team needs to manage it. Not leave it for later or not let it grow. And proper time management. As I told you, time is money. So this is teamwork as a managerial skill. I will upload notes and we'll also do this in a live class. But I hope this has given you at least an idea of what teamwork is. If you have again any problems, feel free to contact me.